Imagine you're sitting in a control room deep inside NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. The hum of servers fills the air. Dozens of monitors glow softly in the darkness, and on one screen, a live feed from the moon. For hours, nothing changes. Craters, shadows, the stillness of a world without wind. But then something moves, not physically, not like a rock tumbling down a ridge. It's subtler than that. A shift in temperature, a flicker in the data, a pattern that shouldn't exist. And when one scientist reviewed the footage, frame by frame, pixel by pixel, they realized something deeply unsettling. The moon is not as dormant as we thought. In fact, what's happening beneath its surface right now could change everything we know about lunar exploration and the safety of every astronaut we plan to send there. This is the story of a warning, a discovery, and a question humanity wasn't ready to ask. What if the moon is waking up? To understand what happened, we need to go back to 2021. That's when NASA reactivated a series of monitoring stations designed to observe the moon in real time. These aren't the grainy, black and white feeds from the Apollo era. These are high-resolution thermal cameras, seismic sensors, and spectrographic instruments capable of detecting changes invisible to the naked eye. The goal was simple. Prepare for Artemis. Prepare to return humans to the lunar surface for the first time in over 50 years. But preparation requires knowledge, and knowledge requires observation. So NASA's Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, along with ground-based observatories and the newly launched Gateway Station, began streaming data continuously, quietly, methodically. For months, everything was routine. The moon behaved exactly as predicted. Surface temperatures rose and fell with the sun's movement. Micrometeorite impacts left fresh craters. Dust particles drifted in the weak exosphere. Business as usual. But in March of 2024, something changed. Dr. Helena Voss, a planetary geologist contracted by NASA's Planetary Science Division, was reviewing thermal imaging data from the Aristarchus Plateau, one of the brightest and most geologically complex regions on the lunar surface. She noticed an anomaly. A small area, no larger than a football field, was emitting heat, not the kind of heat you'd expect from sunlight absorption. This was coming from below the surface. At first, she assumed it was a calibration error. Instruments malfunction all the time in space. But when she cross-referenced the data with seismic sensors left behind by the Apollo 17 mission, sensors that had been silent for decades, she found something chilling. The sensors were active again, and they were recording movement. Dr. Voss wasn't the only one paying attention. Within days, her findings were flagged by NASA's Planetary Defense Coordination Office. Yes, the same group tasked with tracking asteroids that could threaten Earth, but this time, they weren't looking outward. They were looking at the moon. According to internal memos, later shared with the Lunar and Planetary Institute, the concern wasn't about an external threat. It was about the moon itself. Dr. Rajiv Mehta, a seismologist who has studied lunar tectonics for over 20 years, was brought in to analyze the data. In a rare interview with the journal Nature Geoscience, he said this, "What we're seeing is consistent with subsurface structural destabilization. The moon isn't geologically dead. It's geologically dormant, and dormant things can wake up." Let that sink in for a moment. For decades, we've treated the moon like a fossil, a relic, a cold, lifeless rock floating in space. But new evidence suggests the moon still has a molten core, smaller than Earth's, yes, but active. And if that core is shifting, even slightly, it could trigger moonquakes. Now, moonquakes aren't like earthquakes. They're slower, deeper. And because the moon has no atmosphere or water to dampen seismic waves, those vibrations can last for hours. Imagine the ground beneath your feet trembling for an entire day. That's what astronauts could face. But there's something even more troubling. Dr. Elena Ruiz, an astrophysicist at the Space Telescope Science Institute, reviewed the thermal data independently. Her conclusion? This isn't random. The heat signature is appearing in a pattern, almost like a network. If I didn't know better, I'd say something is spreading beneath the surface. A network. Not geological chaos. Not random tectonic shifts. a pattern. Close your eyes for a moment. Picture the moon as you've always known it. Pale, pockmarked, silent. A guardian of Earth's nights, reflecting the sun's light like a mirror hanging in the void. Now imagine zooming in. You descend toward the Aristarchus Plateau, a vast highland glowing faintly blue in Earth's light. The surface is a maze of ridges, rills, and ancient lava flows frozen in time. But beneath that surface, something stirs. 500 meters down, in a cavern carved by volcanic activity billions of years ago, the temperature is rising. Slowly, steadily, the rock begins to shift. Not violently, not yet, just a whisper of movement. A crack widening by millimeters, a release of pressure that hasn't been felt in eons. And then, like dominoes falling in slow motion, the pressure spreads. To another cavern, another fault line. Another pocket of ancient magma that never fully cooled. The moon, silent, still, unchanging for billions of years, is beginning to breathe. Now pull back. From orbit, you can't see any of this. The surface looks the same, but the instruments don't lie. The thermal map lights up in orange and red. The seismic graph spikes. And somewhere deep in NASA's data streams, an alert is triggered. Anomaly detected. Location Aristarchus Plateau. Status monitoring. This isn't science fiction. This is data. And data doesn't care how uncomfortable the truth is. So what does this mean? Why would a scientist issue a warning over something happening hundreds of thousands of miles away? Because we're not just observing the moon anymore. We're going back. NASA's Artemis 3 mission is scheduled to land humans near the lunar South Pole by 2026. The European Space Agency, China's CNSA, and private companies like SpaceX are all planning permanent bases. The moon is about to become humanity's second home. But what if we're building on unstable ground? Dr. Voss, the geologist who first noticed the anomaly, didn't mince words in a presentation to NASA's Safety Review Board. If subsurface thermal expansion continues at this rate, we could see surface fractures, venting events, or even localized collapses. Placing a habitat in an active zone would be catastrophic. Localized collapses. Imagine constructing a lunar base, pressurized modules, life support systems, solar arrays, only to have the ground beneath it crack open. No rescue mission could arrive in time. But the concern goes deeper. Dr. Mehta, the seismologist, pointed out something even more troubling. Lunar dust. On Earth, dust settles. It's held down by gravity, moisture, and atmosphere. On the moon, dust behaves differently. It's electrostatically charged, sharp as glass, and when disturbed, it hovers. If a moonquake triggers a collapse, the resulting dust cloud could coat solar panels, clog equipment, and if it penetrates a habitat, damage lungs beyond repair. One astronaut compared lunar dust to asbestos, except worse. Because on the moon, there's no rain to wash it away. And if the seismic activity Dr. Voss detected is part of a larger pattern, if these heat signatures are appearing in multiple locations across the lunar surface, then we're not just dealing with one unstable zone. We're dealing with a moon that's more geologically active than any current model predicts. And that changes everything. Here's where things get even stranger. After Dr. Ruiz's observation about the network pattern, a team at MIT's Planetary Sciences Lab ran a simulation. They input the thermal data, cross-referenced it with gravitational anomalies detected by NASA's GRAIL mission, and mapped subsurface density variations. What they found was stunning. The heat signatures weren't random. They aligned with ancient lava tubes, vast underground tunnels carved by molten rock billions of years ago. These tubes are enormous. Some are wide enough to fit entire cities. And for years, scientists have proposed using them as natural shelters for lunar habitats. They're shielded from radiation, protected from micrometeorites, and thermally stable. Or so we thought. The MIT simulation suggested something unsettling. If the moon's core is still cooling and contracting, it could be creating stress fractures in these lava tubes. And if those tubes are pressurized with residual volcanic gases, gases that have been trapped for billions of years, they could vent. Dr. Ruiz explained it this way. Imagine a champagne bottle that's been shaken for 4 billion years. Eventually, someone's going to pop the cork. A gas vent on the moon wouldn't look like a volcanic eruption on Earth. There'd be no fire, no lava fountains. But there would be force, enough to eject debris into space, enough to destabilize surface structures, enough to turn a safe landing zone into a hazard. And if astronauts are nearby, exposure to unknown gases, equipment failure, communications blackout, all in an environment where rescue is measured in days, not hours. This is why Dr. Voss issued her warning, not to stop exploration, but to make sure we do it right. Let's zoom out for a moment, because this isn't just about the moon. It's about us. For thousands of years, humans have looked up at the moon and felt something. Comfort. Wonder. A connection to something larger than ourselves. The moon has guided sailors. Inspired poets. Marked the passage of time. And now, for the first time in history, we're preparing to live there. But exploration has always required courage balanced with caution. When the Apollo astronauts first landed on the moon, they didn't know if the surface would hold them. They didn't know if cosmic radiation would fry their instruments. They didn't know if they'd make it home. But they went anyway. Because that's what humans do. We explore, we adapt, we learn, and yes, we take risks. But informed risks are different from reckless ones. Dr. Mehta put it beautifully in a recent interview. The moon isn't our enemy, it's our teacher. And right now, it's teaching us that nature doesn't wait for permission. If we want to build a future there, we need to listen to what it's telling us. Listening means monitoring. It means adjusting mission plans. It means choosing landing sites based not just on convenience, but on safety. And it means accepting that the universe is more complex, more dynamic, and more alive than we ever imagined. Even the moon, cold, distant, unchanging in appearance, holds secrets we're only beginning to understand. Because here's the truth. We've only explored about 5% of the lunar surface up close. The rest? Still a mystery. And mysteries have a way of surprising us. So what happens now? NASA's response has been measured, but serious. Following Dr. Voss's warning, the Artemis mission planning team has expanded its geological survey protocols. New thermal imaging satellites are being deployed. Seismic monitoring stations, far more advanced than the Apollo-era sensors, are scheduled for installation during upcoming robotic missions. The goal is clear. Map the moon's subsurface in unprecedented detail before astronauts set foot there again. But this takes time, and money, and political will. Meanwhile, other nations aren't waiting. China's Chang'e program has already landed multiple missions on the lunar far side. Their planned research station is targeted for completion by 2028. India's Chandrayaan missions are exploring the South Pole, the same region where NASA plans to land. And private companies, they're moving faster than anyone expected. The new space race isn't about flags and footprints. It's about infrastructure, resources, permanence, and that makes understanding the moon's behavior more urgent than ever. Dr. Ruiz warned, if we rush this, if we prioritize speed over safety, we're not just risking missions, we're risking lives. And the first disaster on the moon will set human space exploration back decades. She's right, because the world will be watching. Every launch, every landing, every moment broadcast live to billions of people. One failure, one tragedy, and public support could evaporate. But if we do this right, if we take the warning seriously, invest in the science, and build with wisdom instead of haste, then the moon becomes more than a destination. It becomes a home, a laboratory, a stepping stone to Mars, to the asteroids, to the stars beyond. And that's worth getting right. Let's talk about what this discovery really means. Because beneath the technical jargon and the mission planning, there's a profound shift happening in how we see our place in the cosmos. For most of human history, we believed the heavens were eternal and unchanging. The stars were fixed. The planets wandered, but predictably. The moon waxed and waned, but always looked the same. Then we invented telescopes, and we realized the universe is violent. Stars explode, galaxies collide, black holes devour entire solar systems. But even then, the moon felt safe, familiar, our moon. And now we're learning that even this familiar companion, this constant presence in our night sky, is more dynamic than we thought. It's humbling. It reminds us that nature operates on timescales we struggle to comprehend. A billion years is nothing to the moon. A million year cooling cycle? A geological blink. But to us, it's everything. And that's the beautiful, terrifying truth of exploration. The universe doesn't conform to our expectations. We can model it, predict it, study it with instruments more precise than anything in history. But we can't control it. All we can do is adapt. And adaptation requires humility. It requires admitting when we don't know something. It requires listening to warnings, even uncomfortable ones. Because the scientists issuing these warnings aren't trying to stop progress, they're trying to protect it. They're saying, yes, go to the moon, build there, live there. But do it with your eyes open, because the moon, like all of nature, operates by its own rules. And if we ignore those rules, we do so at our peril. So here we are, standing on the edge of a new era. Humanity is returning to the moon, not as visitors this time, but as settlers. And as we prepare to take that leap, the moon itself is reminding us. This will not be easy. There will be challenges we haven't anticipated. Dangers we're only beginning to understand. But that's what makes it worth doing. Because exploration has never been about certainty. It's about courage. The courage to look at the data, even when it's unsettling, and adjust course. The courage to invest in safety over speed. The courage to admit that the universe is vast, ancient, and full of mysteries we've barely begun to unravel. Dr. Voss's warning wasn't meant to inspire fear. It was meant to inspire respect. Respect for the moon, for the forces that shaped it, for the challenges that await anyone brave enough to call it home, and respect for the fragile balance required to explore responsibly. Because ultimately, this story isn't about heat signatures or moonquakes or subsurface networks. It's about us, about whether we have the wisdom to explore without exploiting, the foresight to listen without arrogance, the humility to remember that we are guests in a cosmos far older and larger than ourselves. The moon is waiting. It's been waiting for billions of years. And now, as we prepare to return, it's offering us a lesson. Proceed with wonder, but also with caution. Because the greatest discoveries aren't made by those who rush headlong into the unknown. They're made by those who take the time to understand it. If stories like this fascinate you, if you believe the universe still has secrets worth uncovering, then subscribe. Because the moon's mystery is just one thread in a cosmic tapestry we're only beginning to see. And the next discovery? It could be even more extraordinary. Thanks for watching. And remember, the universe is just getting started.